Thinking of playing RDF, Rapid Deployment Force. Subtitles: Global Cavalry for the 80s, Strategy and Tactics. War Game, published in 1983. This came out in Strategy and Tactics number 91. Rapid Deployment Force is a tactical level simulation of present day and near future combat, that is the early 80s, in the Persian Gulf region of the Middle East. The game includes six scenarios, each representing a separate hypothetical confrontation between the forces of the United States, Soviet Union, Iran, Iraq, and Syria. Each game turn represents 10 minutes of real time. Each hex represents 200 meters. How to play the game? Just of note, players are required to plan ahead for future actions by issuing commands to their units and having them assume different formations. Morale may suffer as units take losses, forcing them to withdraw from combat. It comes with one standard map, 22 by 34 inches, but the map represents typical Middle Eastern terrain found in Syria and parts of Iran. The map is a real terrain analysis of an area in Syria approximately 20 kilometers north of the Jordanian border. It uses around the border of the map, you have hexes labeled A through J. These are used to indicate where units enter and where they are required to exit during a scenario. We have 10 different unit types. We have armor, and these are the organizational units are platoon level. So we have armor, armored recon, artillery, anti-tank, anti-air, armored personnel carriers or APCs, infantry, engineers, helicopters, and battalion headquarters. So we'll look at an armor unit here. So again, an armor platoon. I have to say right away that there are fronts and backs, and they're relevant to the game. So the back is supposed to have the silhouette. The front is supposed to have the NATO symbol, and this makes a difference. But these were missed die cut, so I'm going to talk about this as the front. Although clearly, as you can see from the die cutting, that would normally be the back. But okay, so the front is the NATO symbol side. We have the company designation, so this is first company here. Below it, in the lower left, is the weapon class. So this armor platoon is a weapon class 1 unit. It's a target class C, or Charlie, and has a movement allowance of 12. So that's the front. The back is the silhouette side. Here we have the platoon, first platoon, slash company, first company, and then just unit silhouette and unit type or name. So an infantry unit, very similar. Third company, 7 weapons class, golf target class, and a movement allowance of 3. And then above the NATO infantry symbol is 2-5. That's the air defense rating strength and range. And then flip it over to its backside, infantry silhouette, first platoon, third company, first platoon, third company. Artillery unit, we've got 102 is the, that's the range in hexes. H is type, artillery type. BN, or for battalion, it's a battalion asset, so it has no company or platoon designation. Weapons class is a dot. Target class is F, Foxtrot, and movement allowance of 14. On the front, So this one does happen to have a first unit name to differentiate it from other BM-21 units. Anti-air unit, battalion asset, weapons class 8, target class E or Echo, movement allowance of 10, air defense, NATO symbol, and above that 4-12, so air defense rating, strength, and range. So air defense rating, strength of 4 to a range of 12. And then one-of-a-kind battalion asset, so we just have the silhouette and the unit name, Azu 23-4. And a helicopter unit, again, battalion asset, again, weapons class 5, agility rating of 2, agility rating, movement allowance of 80, above the NATO symbol 2-15, again, air defense rating, strength of 2 to a range of 15. And I guess some helicopter units can also have an indirect fire rating, range, and type similar to an artillery unit. So, similar to the, indirect fire rating, range, and type, like the 102 Hotel for the ground artillery there. Some helicopter units are going to have that as well, but not this one. This is an AH-1 Sierra, and so that is its silhouette side or backside. Okay, so there are a couple of things that I can think of that distinguish this game. Two things I can think of right off the bat is this game is going to use clearly recognizable formations, which just doesn't seem to be addressed very often in modern tactical gaming. Hex Encounter. Probably more likely in miniatures, but anyways. The other thing that distinguishes this game is that it uses a full, what it calls a pregame randomization sequence. Basically, there are 6 scenarios, but each scenario, both players are going to be rolling dice several times, consulting different tables to determine the exact particulars of that scenario. I know from some discussions that not all war gamers are really excited about that, interested in that, or think that's such a good idea. Not only do I like the idea, I pretty much, in my own thinking about game design, I think in a game like this, it's pretty much, again, in my opinion, mandatory. I don't know why game designer wouldn't do that, but it's done so rarely. Or at least that's my impression so far. Maybe I'm wrong about that. Okay, so I'm just going to jump right in, because you can't with this game, you can't just choose a scenario from a scenario card, set out your orders of battle, set up, and get going with the sequence of play. You can't do that here. So we're going to jump right into the pregame randomization sequence. So I'm going to talk about this, but there is, of the 6 scenarios, the first scenario is recommended for players new to the game. That is the one that I'm going to be playing. But one of the steps in the pre-game randomization sequence is to actually roll for the scenario itself. Rules as written, players don't choose the scenario, although you can, of course. But the pre-game randomization sequence includes a step for rolling randomly for the scenario, which I guess would create even more unpredictability and variability, I guess. But here, I think players can easily choose, okay, first time through with the game, we'll go ahead and follow the recommendation, and we're just going to play the first scenario, so we're not actually rolling for that step. So there is a procedure. Generally, you're going to be dicing for first player, not here because, well, it's solo. Okay, but generally you're going to be dicing for first player. Then you're going to be dicing for the scenario played. Then you're going to be dicing for the entry and exit hexes and the axis or axes of advance. You're going to be dicing for the overall orders or the higher orders and the victory conditions. You're going to be dicing for the battalion headquarters rating. You're going to be dicing for the formation of entry. You're going to be dicing for the number of airstrikes and the game turn of availability. And you're going to be dicing for the movement allowance for game turn one. So with 8 printed steps in this procedure, it's even just that rundown should give an idea that we're talking a lot of variability for what is really just a tactical platoon scale Mideast, primarily hardware centric shoot 'em up. So step one is each player rolls one die. This is to determine the first player. I'm not going to do that here. Step two is rolling for the scenario. Again, 6 scenarios, you roll a 6-sided die. Again, I'm choosing the first scenario. So the first scenario is called Iran 1980. The first player is the Iranian player. And the Iranian player is basically distinguished by having the scorpions and the chieftains. So the first player, the Iranian forces, are the Tan forces. Okay, while I'm talking about it, I'll show it. So I've set out the order of battle. These are the Iranian forces. Again, they're the Tan forces, distinguished by the scorpion chieftain and BTR 60s. 60s, yeah. Other than that, we've got some infantry, some M125s, an M109 platoon, a Rapier platoon, and a Zoo 1234 platoon, and a battalion headquarters. And then the second player is the Iraqi Armored Battalion. They are the brown forces. So the Iraqi forces. Brown forces here, they've got, they're distinguished by T-55s, BTR-60 platoon, an engineer platoon, 3 BM-21 platoons, also a ZU-23-4 platoon, and a battalion headquarters. So, Iranian first player, Tan forces, Iraqi second player, brown forces. Those were the two first two steps, determining first player and determining the scenario, which we've done. Now, steps 3 through 8 are each performed separately by each player, and they are going to record the results of their roles on the pregame randomization tables to refer to throughout the game. So I'm going to record the results for each side. And these are not shown, these are secret. You don't reveal until the end of the game, end of the scenario. Okay, so go through. Well, I'll go through each step one at a time. Iranian and Iraqi, first player and second player. Okay, so for step 3, the Iranian player rolls 2 a die. First die 4, second die 6. And we use the entry-exit hex table. I'll just give a... I'm not going to show all these, but these are the example of all the tables I'm going to be using to determine the setup of this particular game. So the first result is a 4, and first player table. I want to show that there's a first player table and a second player table with an explanation. So using the first die is a 4, second die is a 5 or a 6, is a 6. So the entry hex is Delta, exit hex is Hotel. So It's step three. Result is Delta to hotel. And then we'll do this step for the Iraqi player. First roll is a 1-1, and the second roll is a 1. So 1-1. On the second player table, 1-1. Okay, so step three is Juliet to Echo. And so these, again, around the map, on the edge, again, are those hexes labeled A through J. And so this is telling you, in particular, where, what side of the map, and what road they're coming in on, and where they're headed to get off. I mean, all the scenarios have a concept of coming on, meeting engagement, and exiting, which I like. Not that all games have to be like that, but it's meeting engagements can be fun, and that's what you're basically doing here. Or at least variations on the meeting engagement. All right, step four is players roll one die, so go back to the Iranians. Step four, roll one die and consult the orders table. So they roll a three. This is step four. Roll three is reduce. So the overall orders are to reduce. And then that tells you what that means. Here, I'll show this again. So roll a three on the orders table. Overall orders reduce, and victory conditions tells you what that is. To eliminate one company and two battalion assets. Exit remainder of force through entry hex. Oh, wow. Exit remainder of force through entry hex. I had forgotten there's even that twist. Huh. All right. Interesting. So there you go. That's overall orders. So for the Iraqis, roll a four. Oh, they have a reduced two. Okay, that's going to be interesting. So they also have a reduced order, but a slightly different victory conditions. Explanation, eliminate one company, that's the same, two battalion assets, or route two companies. Exit remainder of force through entry hex. So that makes it sound like we have the two forces coming on, fighting out to destroy a certain amount, and then reverse and get back off the same way they came. Interesting. Okay. Step five is roll two dice and consult the battalion headquarters rating table. All right, so for the Iranians, okay, so roll two dice, add them together for six. Appropriate column. Okay, so battalion headquarters rating table. All right, I guess I am going to show these because they are so unique. Two dice roll, 2 through 12. We have one column for USA or USSR. Obviously, we only have Iranians and Iraqis here, so we're going to use the other column. The Iranians rolled a 6 again, so they have a 1. Is lower good or bad? So I'll just show exactly what I'm doing. Looking at the formation change table, you have battalion headquarters rating 1 through 4. And again, a two dice roll. So this is during play. C means that the formation change is successful. Dash means no formation change. So that looks like lower is better. One is much better than four. So the Iranian headquarters is, you know, top notch. And then we do the Iraqi headquarters. Oh, they rolled the same. So we have the same. We have two. two top-notch battalion headquarters going against each other. Okay, that'll be interesting. Step six is players roll two dice. And, alright, a nine. Players roll two dice and consult the formation of entry table to determine the formation in which each force enters the game. Once we add, oh, should pay attention to this. Add to the die roll the number rolled when determining orders. That's, I thought there was a reason why I wanted to record my dice rolls. All right, I think the Iranians were a three, right? So 9, 10, 11, 12, right? Adding the orders. Yeah, 3, nine, so it's 12. Formation of entry table is a movement to contact. MTC, okay. For the Iraqis, they roll a 10 plus the 4 that they had from there. So that's 14. So they, 13 to 16, formation of entry table, they come in a hasty assault. Hasty assault. Hasty assault. Okay. And then step 7. All right. Players roll one die twice. Okay. So green will be the second die. Exalt the airstrike table to determine the number of strikes available and the game turn on which they begin to arrive. Okay. So one and two. All right. So airstrike table. Okay. So one. Huh. I modifiers to die roll. When rolling the die a second time for game turn availability, add the die the current battalion headquarters less one. Okay. But it looks like they don't get any airstrikes. I guess that's that. So the Iraqis. Oh, very different. Okay, so looks like the Iranians get 0, 7 is 6, 4 airstrikes per turn. Okay, and then they start 3 plus, oh, nothing, because the battalion headquarters rating is 1. So battalion headquarters rating 1 adds nothing to the roll. So 3, but that's good. It's start game turn available. I guess it starts on 5. Okay. And then step 8. Players roll one die and consult the first turn movement table to determine whether they have full or half their movement points available on game turn 1. So 3. Let's see what modifiers there are. Each player rolls a die once to determine whether his recon unit will enter the map with its full movement allowance or half its allowance. Units entering. Okay, they have full. So. So, okay, and then the Iraqis. Okay, they have full two. So both of the recon units will enter the board with full movement allowance. Okay, once the pre-game randomization sequence is complete, made all the die rolls, gone through the tables, recorded all that information. Again, this is secret. Recorded secretly from each side and only revealed at the end of the game. But now we are ready to begin. So again, we're starting with a empty map and going right into the sequence of play. So so the game turn sequence has a phase A, second player command phase, And then we have phase B, first player indirect fire phase, but phases A and B are not performed on the first game turn. So we're skipping those for this first for the first game turn. So we're going right to phase C of the game turn sequence, which is the first player movement phase. So we know that the first player, which is the Iranian side, their recon unit is going to enter. So as a matter of fact, again, first player is Iranian. We know that their recon unit is going to enter in the Delta Hex on the edge of the map, which is actually on that side of the map. I can see it right now. And they're going to have their full movement allowance. So I guess the first turn is really quick as each side... here, this is what I'm looking at. So it's going to go by quickly because each side... the scenario tells you that the game turn one, the Scorpion recon platoon enters, and then game turn two is the rest of the force for the Iranians, and it's the same thing for the second player or the Iraqi armored battalion. First turn, the PT-76 recon platoon enters, game turn two, the rest of the force. So by that, I think we're going to bring the recon platoons onto the board. I guess then I'm thinking we go to game turn two and get the main forces on. Now the main forces coming on is going to be when we start looking at the formations. So we're going to look at the formations, but in play here we have administrative march, movement to contact, hasty assault, deliberate assault, and hasty defense, deliberate defense. And basically the arrows tell you in what I think in what order you can go. And then again we have that formation change table. Dice roll cross with the battalion headquarters rating. We know that on each side we have top-notch ones going against each other. So that'll be interesting.